Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Important notice. The contents of this documentary video will undoubtedly disturb all anti-Jacob Zuma supporters. Everything revealed here was submitted under oath in the ongoing case between the Electoral Commission of South Africa versus uMkhonto, Wesizwe political party and Jacob Kedelisekisa Zuma. Constitutional Court Case Number CCT 97/24, but has been deliberately withheld from public knowledge. These court documents are now available on the official website of Liberty Fighters Network LFN at www.libertyfighters.org and on our Telegram platform at Liberty Fighters News for your scrutiny. Reyno De Beer, the president of LFN, has officially declared his willingness to testify and present further damning evidence to any judicial commission of inquiry and to undergo an independent polygraph test to validate his revelations. This documentary is presented in two parts, part 1 and part 2. Should these videos be removed from any social media platform, they remain accessible directly on our website. Good day, liberators and fellow South Africans. Unfortunately, this is bad news. And this is probably the most important video I've ever made since I've started my YouTube channel for Liberty Fighters Network. And the information contained in here is so important that you have to forward this to as many possible people that you can. Because this has got a direct impact on your liberation and your freedoms in this country. And the problem is, why I want you to share it is because I have now determined that there is indeed a collusion going on between all media houses in South Africa, most probably created by the South African National Editors Forum, SANEF, where it was supposed to be created to encourage freedom of speech and expression, to enforce that constitutional right of ours. It appears as if this forum is now being utilized to actually decide what news you and I must hear. And sadly, I have now confirmed, because the information I'm going to share with you is undoubtedly of national importance, not actually for us South Africans only, but also for the African people and for many others in the entire world, because Jacob Zuma has been labeled in the media as this terrible, corrupt person. But unfortunately, if the information I'm going to share with you now has been blacked out for at least 2 years now in the entire media, that no media house ever have published anything about this, it can be that other positive information can also be blacked out in the same way. And unfortunately, people has got this negative attitude created by the mainstream media of Jacob Zuma. And I'm not here to say that he is corrupt or he's not corrupt. I'm just, as a reasonable person and the president of Liberty Fighters Network, I believe in balanced information. I believe that you, as a citizen of South Africa and of the world, must have enough information in front of you so that you can decide what is the correct position in your mind. But unfortunately, if you wear yellow spectacles and you stand over the N1 highway in Gauteng between Johannesburg and Pretoria and you look down with those yellow spectacles, you will only see yellow cars. So at the end of the day, if just a certain narrative is being pushed by the media of South Africa and you don't have the other information before you because they're simply blacking it out, then you will believe eventually that Jacob Zuma is corrupt, although he has not been found guilty by a court of law of any wrongdoing up till now. You can go out and you can have your opinion, but I'm just asking you that If you are one of those who think that Jacob Zuma is this corrupt person, just listen to what I'm going to share with you, and then you decide whether that is fair. And for those of you who do support Jacob Zuma, please ensure that this information gets out as quickly as possible and far and wide as possible before the elections are coming. We are days away, literally, from the national elections, and the content that I'm going to share with you will most probably have an extremely important impact on the outcome of the elections. And the fact that the media of South Africa is intentionally and deliberately blocking this information, there cannot be any free and fair elections in South Africa, especially if the outcome of the election will again show that the ANC or DA or so have obtained more votes than the uMkhonto Wesizwe party. And especially regarding the candidacy of Jacob Zuma, which is now at play before the Constitutional Court. You have to hear this, because Jacob Zuma and the uMkhonto Wesizwe party have been, their rights have been violated. And in the process, their supporters' rights. And any potential voter that is still undecided whether he or she is going to vote for whichever party, and without this information, he or she is going to vote for the incorrect party, maybe. It's so important that you share this, please. And let me jump into this. And I just want to reiterate that, notwithstanding the fact that Liberty Fighters Network and myself are the representatives for Jacob Zuma, before the African Commission on Human People's Rights, we have a political stance. So we give assistance to the message of political parties we believe can benefit the people of South Africa. uMkhonto Wesizwe and the Organic Humanity Movement are just two of them. I must be honest, I don't think that there are any other party at this point in time which can actually put any benefit to the people of South Africa besides those two political parties. I've gone through their manifestos, and I think that they are definitely in line with what we have to achieve. And both of them are forerunners to change the constitution of South Africa, because it has come to a point whereby the constitution of South Africa is not protecting our rights at all. The constitution of South Africa is being sidestepped all the time. It's enforced in such a way to be selective. It does not protect the actual rights of the people of South Africa, because of the fact that there's this limitation of rights clause, whereby the government can at any time decide that they can relax or violate any of these rights as they choose. That the limitation of rights clause should never have been in the constitution. And another very important clause that should never have been there is section 173, whereby the courts, the superior courts in South Africa, so the High Court, the Supreme Court of Appeal, and the Constitutional Court, have been authorized to regulate its own processes. And sadly, the courts have come to a point whereby they are actually regulating their own processes in such a way that they are actually changing the laws and the constitution of South Africa. That needs to be stopped. And unfortunately, the only two parties at this point in time which can do that is the uMkhonto Wesizwe party, who wants to change the constitution, and also the Organic Humanity Movement. I truly believe that they are both on the right track in that specific for that specific reason why Liberty Fighters Network would try and assist them at all costs that we can. But let me go back to the IEC matter currently before the Constitutional Court, where we're still waiting. Today is Friday. I believe it's the 17th of May, if I'm not mistaken. A lot of things have happened in the back line, behind the curtains, which the media intentionally decided that you may not hear. Because when the IEC started to say that Jacob Zuma cannot be a candidate, the MK party and Jacob Zuma went to the Electoral Court. The Electoral Court decided unanimously that Jacob Zuma may stand as a candidate. What the IEC did was a very strange thing. They did go to the Constitutional Court requesting direct access, or that is what I believe they did or should have done. Although I never received the actual papers of it, and notwithstanding that I've requested that from the legal team of Jacob Zuma, but leave it as it may. I was under the impression, and I truly hope, that the Electoral Court, when the matter went to the Electoral Court, would have known that that there is a pending matter before the African Commission on Human People's Rights. It's an international process that's going on. And they would have been briefed by at least the president or the Department of International Relations and Cooperation of the content of the decision that may not be made public at this point in time, so that they know that this decision was taken and that this is applying, that decision applies to the interpretation at the end of the day of whether imprisonment sentence of Jacob Zuma should actually bar him to be a candidate in the upcoming national elections. So when the decision was came out of the court and it was in favor of Jacob Zuma and the MK party, I believe that they were briefed. And the fact that they did not give any reasons at that point in time and just an order, I honestly thought that, okay, they knew about this pending case and that they cannot interfere with those international processes pending the outcome, the final outcome of the African Commission's process. If you can still remember, just to get to this point, when the BRICS summit was held in South Africa, the Democratic Alliance quickly went to the High Court to get an order that South Africa must adhere to international law, in the sense that the IEC made a decision, the International Criminal Court made a decision to arrest Vladimir Putin the moment when he puts his feet on the soil of South Africa. And if you can still remember that the court agreed that international law must be respected and applies to South Africa, and that they have to adhere to the IEC's order. So that was a confirmation. But regrettably, it now appears as if the fact that there's an international process going on before the African Commission on People's Rights, specifically to challenge the imprisonment sentence by the Constitutional Court and all two other, there's actually three Constitutional Court judgments relevant to the imprisonment, and all three of them are being challenged at before the African Commission on People's Rights. Unfortunately, it appears that the international law does not apply to Jacob Zuma, because there is this process going on before the African Commission on People's Rights, and the right thing for the Independent Electoral Commission, the South African Electoral Commission of South Africa (IEC), to have done was to have said, okay, South Africa, there is this decision that they know the outcome of, and pending the finalization of this entire process, we cannot proceed in any way against Jacob Zuma, inclusive of making a judgment or a finding in terms of what the remission and his imprisonment sentence actually mean in context of Section 47 of the Constitution, allegedly prohibiting him to be a candidate. So what happened was that the moment when the IEC suddenly went to the Constitutional Court to challenge the outcome of the Electoral Court, and they were adamant that we don't have any information, and that is part of the reason why we want the Constitutional Court to intervene and make this declaration about the remission and the imprisonment meaning within the context of Jacob Zuma. I just thought, but what is going on here now? Because it appeared as if the Electoral Court knew what was going off the process. And what I then did was, and let me show you this, I then wrote a letter on behalf of Jacob Zuma as his representative, this was not new, and I will show you that I also wrote a letter about the same thing to the National Commissioner of Correctional Services when he had to decide on whether Jacob Zuma had to go back to a prison or not. So what I did was, in a similar way, I wrote a letter to Chief Justice Zondo, making him aware of the existence of this decision and the process before the African Commission on Human People's Rights. And in strict confidentiality, I've conveyed the outcome of the decision as well to him. And so in order for him to know, because the court cannot make an informed decision in absence of having all the facts. And I've made it known that it is important that the court knows about this because of the fact that the judgment was that sent Jacob Zuma to prison was not was one made by the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court is not at liberty to adjudicate this matter currently. They have to postpone it pending the outcome of the decision by the final decision of the African Commission on Human People's Rights because of its direct involvement in that complaint, and that is an international process which should be respected. So I've sent this email to Jacob to him. Oh, there is the letter that I wrote to Chief Justice Zondo on the 26th of April 2024. Urgent, strictly confidential in national security, because that is what it is, that international law prohibits South Africa as the party, as the state party and the complainant to make this known to the public. So I wrote to him to inform him specifically, 8 pages, and so I'm not going to go into the confidential parts of that, but this is the letter, and I just want to show you as well the actual letter that was, yes, here is the stamped version thereof. Let me just bring it closer. So you can see that on the Constitutional Court received this on the 26th of April 2024. So this is the letter and the full document disclosed to Chief Justice Zondo. Now, Chief Justice Zondo would have informed all the other judges of the existence thereof, because it entails the entire Constitutional Court and how they're going to adjudicate this matter before them by the IEC. Notwithstanding that it was delivered and he read it and obviously had to communicate it to the other judges as well, they decided to proceed. When I delivered that notice to the registrar of the court, he did ask me when I delivered it to him personally at the Constitutional Court on the 26th of April to go and file it so that he can send a copy to the Chief Justice. He indicated that he does have it now for his records. He will keep it confidential, not for the others to see in the registry as well. And he then asked me, why don't you bring a application to be admitted as an amicus curiae, a friend of the court? So I've told him, well, the problem is that it's a confidential decision that was taken, so the contents cannot be divulged. So divulging it in an application for amicus curiae would mean without previously set restrictions on the distribution of it, and that it needs to be treated as highly confidential and also only to be addressed in camera before the court. He indicated, yes, do that, but I said, okay, but I cannot divulge it. So that's why I have to do it in this way. So he understood. Irrespective thereof, the process continued. So I thought, okay, no, this cannot be, because directions have been issued. And then on the Friday, I'm not sure, I think it was around early in May. On the Friday, let me just put it this way, that I've tried to communicate with Jacob Zuma, although I have been regularly communicating with him about his case. But for some reason, my communication was just cut off from him. So I've struggled all the channels that I use to communicate with him. And remember, I'm sitting in Pretoria and he's in KZN most of the times. So the communication that the channels that I had with him about his case did not go through. I, when I phoned the numbers, it was just dead, voicemail. It became very strange to me that suddenly I cannot communicate with him. So eventually, because he used to have certain attorneys which he used to use, and I had communication with them. I contacted them and asked them, well, are you involved in the IEC matter? Because at that stage, I didn't follow the news at all. But in any event, the attorney said, no, he's not on the record and he doesn't know except for Dalium Porfu. But I've been communicating with Dalium Porfu, sending him communication through on his cell phone, and he did not, and he did not respond to me at all. So what I did was that I communicated with, I managed to go, the moment when the judgment came out, or the reasons of judgment for the electoral court came out, I then saw who the attorneys were, Zungu attorneys, and I've communicated directly, managed to get hold of Mr. Zungu, Victor Zungu, and that was the Friday. And so he was totally flabbergasted when I've informed him about the African Union case. So he wasn't aware of it. And let me just put it this way to you, that when I've decided to assist and lodge this complaint on behalf of Jacob Zuma, there was an understanding that he wanted to keep his international case away from his local case, because he doesn't want the two to clash. And it turned out to be very successful, because the African Union case run by me had several positive results along the way. And the fact that the media was not covering it as well made it very simple, actually, to maneuver this case to the point of the decision that was made during March 2024. So he didn't want, he wanted to keep the local cases separate from his international ones. So when I communicated with Victor Zungu on the Friday, he was totally amazed by what was going on and very excited, because he never knew about the African Commission process. And he said that, he just had a meeting with Jacob Zuma the previous day, and he didn't tell him about it, because I probably believe that Jacob Zuma also accepted that nothing strange will happen, because Cyril Ramaphosa, as the instructor to challenge and oppose the matter at the African Union level, would make sure that the actual decision and the processes would have been conveyed to the IEC and to everyone concerned, so that they know the background. And so he was obviously not worried about the outcome or the positive outcome thereof. Leave it as it may. So Victor Zungu then said, but he wanted to discuss that with Dalium Porfu. And I thought, well, I've communicated this to Dalium Porfu and I didn't receive any feedback. So he was also put back by that. And I've indicated to him, well, I don't know whether how busy Dalium Porfu is and whether he did take note of what I conveyed to him. So I've tried to be very diplomatic when it came to Dalium Porfu. But leave it as it may. Over the weekend, in fact, on Saturday, the following Saturday, or the day just after, I've received a phone call from Victor, and he asked me whether I can't maybe intervene as a party, as an amicus or so. And I've discussed the issue with the confidentiality, and we then agreed that I need to come on board, intervene as an amicus or as an interested party as such, and then just say that the court is aware of the decision, and that it must be kept confidential, and not specifically made any specific mention of the decision that was taken, and then we can and then I can at least argue the matter of the fact that the entire remission imprisonment matter is before the African Union at this point in time, and that the court cannot make a decision on that because the Constitutional Court is directly involved in that case. But so on Monday, I did submit an intervention application in terms of Rule 8 and Rule 10 of the Constitutional Court rules. So I've made it extensive and put in all the relevant information pertaining to my direct interest in the matter. Rule 8 is all about intervention of as an interested party, meaning that you are directly involved in the matter, which I was. And then also Rule 10 is to be admitted to intervene as an amicus curiae, which means that you are then just a simple friend of the court, telling the court, giving the court more information. So I've made it on both legs, that application, and I will just show you this. It is okay. This is the application that I've lodged. And please take note, or I'll show you now whatever I want to show you. So this is the application. It specifically says that application for leave to intervene as interested party or as an amicus curiae. I've indicated here that the application should be heard concurrently with the main application, and that the urgency of the main case must also apply to this one. That the applicant, Reyno De Beer, is admitted as either an intervening party or as an amicus curiae in these proceedings in terms of either Rule 8 or Rule 10 of the rules of the Constitutional Court. So this specifically shows that I wanted to intervene as either an interested party, or if the court does not find that I'm an interested party, at least as an amicus curiae. So what the content of this affidavit is, what is so important that needs to be shared. Because not only have I come out and show the proof that I have been the representative for Jacob Zuma before the African Commission on Human People's Rights about his imprisonment sentence specifically, I've also revealed the conflict of interest of, in this specific case, Tembeka Ntshaitshikobi, who was the lead counsel for the IEC in this matter. I've made it known, the public redacted public document can be obtained on our Telegram platform, Liberty Fighters Network News, where this have been published. Now, why I've said that there was a conflict of interest is because of the fact that CASAC, the Council for the Advancement of the South African Constitution, had been admitted as a friend of the court, amicus curiae, together with two others. But strangely, all of those three advanced arguments in support of the IEC's position. So where Tembeka, why I say that there's a clash of interest, conflict of interest, is the fact that Tembeka is also a member, physical member, and sits on its advisory council for CASAC. But this is not a new thing that happened, because exactly the same conflict of interest happened throughout the three cases which resulted in the imprisonment of Jacob Zuma, where Tembeka was also acting on behalf of the Zondo Commission at that point in time, while CASAC was a physical party in both the first one, I call it the initiating judgment, because that is where Jacob Zuma was then told you must appear before the Zondo Commission. And then there was the imprisonment sentence judgment dated the 29th of June 2021. And then there was a rescission application later on, which was brought and never final, never actually became relevant, because by that time, Jacob Zuma was actually put on parole and released. But in any event, now, throughout those three processes, CASAC was either directly or indirectly a party to those proceedings. And the strange thing is that Tembeka Ntshaitshikobi was at that point in time also the counsel together with Wim Trengove on the so-called CR-17 public protector constitutional case, which judgment also came out on the 1st of July 2021, merely 2 days after the imprisonment judgment of Jacob Zuma. But let me just show you this. So this is my affidavit that I've lodged on in this case on the 6th of May. And I've revealed the under oath, I would like to emphasize from the outset that LFN had been representing former President Mr. Zuma, the second respondent in the main application, as his agent and duly authorized representative in respect of a complaint lodged for him on 19 January against the State of the Republic of South Africa with the African Commission on Human People's Rights, an executive organ of the African Union. Find attached as Annexure A, a redacted letter received from the Commission's former Executive Secretary, Mrs. Lindiwe Kumale, dated the 15th of March 2022 as confirmation. So I've revealed and gave the proof Annexure A, and let me go to Annexure A. There is the letter, Mr. Reyno De Beer, Liberty Fighters Network. This is just private information there, and this is a confirmation of the lodgement of that case. And subsequently, there were other proofs as well, communication between me and them. This was when they formally seized the case, to say that the communication decided to be seized of it. So it means that there's a we've complied with the application process, so then they actually continuing with it. But leave it as it may, let me go back to the statement. So I've informed them about this. But the revelations that were made in this is that what you need to read this document in its entirety, because there is that in this I've highlighted how the IEC was supposed, as an organ of state, was supposed to know about what was going on, and apparently it's unlikely that the IEC did not know, and that the president would not have briefed them about the outcome of the decision itself, and of the processes before the African Commission. And then very importantly, that we said here that most importantly, it is my stance that we have remained silent until now to afford ample opportunity for the president and his cabinet to demonstrate the expected transparency of our executive branch and personally inform the people of our country about the existence of the African Commission on Human People's Rights Challenge. Unfortunately, our hope in the executive was overestimated and has not been realized. And the president and his cabinet have betrayed the trust of the people by failing to inform them of the commission's matter and keeping it concealed from the court of public opinion. From a personal perspective, I believe that the collaborative effort between seemingly unlikely individuals like Mr. Zuma, an outspoken African tribalism leader, and myself, an Afrikaans-speaking Boer, does not align with the contemporary narrative of an alleged racially and culturally divided society propagated by the president and his handlers, President Cyril Ramaphosa, obviously, in that respect. And this part is very important because a Zulu has collaborated now with a Boer, with an Afrikaans-speaking Boer, to challenge this outcome of the imprisonment sentence. So that is totally in contrast to, in direct contrast to what the media is pushing, that we are racially divided and culturally divided South Africa. So we are not together in fighting the evil in front of us. So so obviously, if the media would have 2 years ago suddenly followed this case, it would have been very strange, because then they couldn't have pushed the we are the whites and the blacks are racist against one another, and there's cultural divisions and blah 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 blah, and in fact that we are as a country much more united in our diversity than what the media want to portray. And whoever have instructed all the media houses not to publish anything about this are the ones at the end of the day who wants us to be divided. Because as long as we believe that we are divided as people of South Africa, then they can just continue with what they are doing. And what I'm now exposing is exactly the corruption that's really going on. And I am willing to state under oath, to testify under oath before a judicial commission, similar like the Zondo Commission that was held for Jacob Zuma. I am prepared to also be on that commission and testify before it under oath. And I want to go a step further, that everything that I'm revealing to you is absolutely the truth, and I'm willing to undergo a polygraph test in public. If the media houses wants to televise that, then please let them do. Because everything that I'm stating in here is the truth and what I'm revealing. And I'm challenging the president, Ramaphosa, the IEC, the constitutional court judges, and all the legal teams involved in this cover-up, inclusive of that of the of Zuma himself. I challenge them to do exactly the same, and find me that I'm the one that is lying about this. I've got a total open heart about this, and specifically, not once I'm treating Jacob Zuma exactly the same as any one of our other members and supporters who we are assisting in their cases too. I'm treating him exactly like a human being. He's also, I've told him that he's also entitled that we do not expect anything in return from any one of them, and I haven't expected anything in return from him either. So they, at no stage did he take out a million or two or whatever the case may be, and you're welcome to come and investigate if you really want to. At no stage have he given any money to us. I'm not aware of any payment or any donation, voluntary donation, that Jacob Zuma has done up to that. Because of the fact that we've said that we actually don't want that, because then people would say, oh, but you are receiving money from him, so you would obviously speak in his favor. And there will still be people, as I know very well, after all these revelations that I'm making, who would say that, oh, Reyno De Beer is saying this because he is in the pocket of Jacob Zuma. People, I've shown a lot of money to the dustbin, because once you receive money in that way, you are owned by them. You then sell your life to Satan, and I'm not prepared to do that. I love my life, and I love my religion and my God, and I'm not prepared to sell my soul to Satan at all. So let me just get back to the facts. So strangely enough, irrespective of this application and the logic that I have to be admitted as an amicus curiae, a friend of the court, one day later, on the 7th of May, so I've submitted it on the Monday, the 6th, and that afternoon on the 7th, I've received this by Bilchich, Campbell, Matlanga, Matopa, Majid, Muntlata, Teron, and Tiki, unanimously agreeing that the Constitutional Court has considered the application for admission as amicus curiae and has concluded that the applicant does not raise any novel arguments. Consequently, the application is dismissed. The court has decided not to hold any costs. Most of you would agree that this information that I'm sharing with you now, and that was revealed in the application, was definitely not something that was revealed before. So it would have been a novel argument. But what is interesting about this is that they have only adjudicated this, the application for admission as amicus curiae is dismissed. And if you can remember that my application was in fact for, let me just quickly see that. Let me go back. The application was for either, as either an intervening party in terms of Rule 8, or as an amicus curiae in terms of Rule 10. So therefore, the Constitutional Court unanimously decided that I may not be an amicus. Okay, so I was sitting, okay, but what about the Rule 8? Did you see it? Or have you considered the amicus curiae part, and you're going to issue directions for the Rule 8 interested party part? Because I'm definitely an interested party. You know about the African Commission, because I've informed you on the 26th of April yet via Chief Justice Zondo. But you are saying that I cannot be an amicus, but maybe I might be an interested party, because I definitely is an interested party. Okay. So I was waiting, but in my papers I did inform them that I would be leaving between Wednesday and Friday. I cannot be involved in any procedures because of the fact that I had to attend court in Bloemfontein to attend to my contempt of court trial that was also going on for 2 years or so, which the state is prosecuting on behalf of the Supreme Court of Appeal, a very interesting matter also to be followed. But in any case, so I was waiting then for directions, hopefully for the Rule 8 part. But strangely, on Friday morning, on the 10th of May, to be exact at 8:39 in the morning, I received a phone call from Mr. Victor Zungu, the attorney for Mr. Zuma, and also for the MK party. So he then asked me, where am I? I thought, thought, oh, okay. He knew that I was in Bloemfontein because I've told him that the week before. So I thought, oh, you in Bloemfontein? Oh, where in Bloemfontein are you? No, I'm not in Bloemfontein. I'm asking, where are you for the hearing today? What hearing? Well, the Jacob Zuma IEC case will be heard today. So I was totally dumbstruck and said, okay, I wasn't aware of it because I do not follow the news. That is one principle that I don't do. I believe that do not follow the news will come to you. That's my principle. So if news does not come to me, I don't care about it and I don't cry about it. But in any event, so I said, okay, I wasn't aware. And he inquired about my status of admittance. And he was basically under the impression that I would have been at court that day to argue my intervention. And I said, but I wasn't informed by the registrar that there would have been a court case. But then he informed me that apparently the night before, Ola Bono Renaissance Foundation, also a well-known social justice organization, Preding Mutuping, is constantly, regularly intervening in cases as an amicus curiae also to advance additional arguments for the people. But in any case, apparently they were admitted on Thursday as an amicus, and they would have been the first and only, at that stage, amicus curiae which would advance argument on in line with the position of Jacob Zuma and the MK party. So I thought, okay, so they I thought that they were dismissed before, but Zungu then said, but they were admitted, or as he believed at that point in time. So I just said, okay, well, I'm in Bloemfontein, I'm busy with my trial still, but I'm almost finished and I can be back in Gauteng at around lunch, and then I can see whether I can then come and intervene. But unfortunately, I had car trouble along the way from Bloemfontein to Gauteng, and my trip was delayed back to Pretoria, and I couldn't make it that afternoon in any event. But I believe that, okay, well, I should have been informed by the registrar if they needed me. So along the way, I've heard on the radio, usually I switch off at the half an hour's every 30 minutes, I switch off the news. I don't want to listen to the news. But at that point in time, when I was driving, it was mentioned that the recusal application of the judges have been dismissed. So all judges basically said that, no, they can proceed with this case. So at that moment, I was just, what is going on here? Because in the notice I've sent to Zonda, I've specifically indicated that the Constitutional Court itself must recuse itself because it cannot hear a matter while the matter is the complaint against them, for they being the part of the South African the Republic of South Africa's case of allegedly violating the rights of Jacob Zuma, they are part and parcel of it, so they cannot adjudicate something that is before the African Commission. So I was here really, at that point, I just thought, what is going on here? And regrettably, by the time I got back to home, it was late afternoon, early evening, and I then subsequently listened to the entire court case on YouTube. It was recorded, and I was just amazed. Not once did the judges, not once did anyone of the parties, knowing the content of my intervention application that was dismissed, not once did anyone raise the issue of the African Commission case. It's as if it's not in existence at all. So at that point in time, I thought, okay, this is, I can't believe, because even the legal, even Dalim Pofu, who have spoken to me, I believe, on Tuesday, just shortly after the dismissal by the Constitutional Court, unanimous decision taken by 8 of their judges that I will not have a novel argument. He phoned me, and we had a discussion, and he apologized that he didn't get back to me and he didn't know, blah, 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 blah. And I then forwarded him my application. Apparently, he was not aware of my application that was lodged the previous day. So I've emailed him all the communication, and I assumed that they would have made work of it. Regrettably, they have not. And I do not believe for 1 minute that Jacob Zuma have told them, not to communicate with me, because the communication between me and Jacob Zuma was very, very positive each and every time I visited him or communicated with him over the phone. He was very excited about the exciting news before the African Union. I, in fact, as he has stated, have done more for him free of charge in a very small time space than all his legal teams could have achieved over decades since his legal challenges started. So I, in fact, had more positive results free of charge, not expecting anything from him, than all the millions of rand his legal teams received in the process. So I do not believe for one minute that Jacob Zuma would suddenly, now that everything is positive before the African Union and there's results and there's a pending decision that needs to be made known, etc., etc., I don't believe for one minute that he is behind this. So all the channels around him, communication channels, have evaporated suddenly. And I truly believe, after I've heard the revelations by someone like Louis Liebenberg, like him if you want, dislike him, hate him, whatever the case may be, but he did indicate relatively recently that he apparently paid something like 28 million rand or something to the legal costs of Jacob Zuma. That's very strange. And he did indicate that Dalim Pofu also communicated with him regarding some comrade that needed help, and he also made payments to him. That is what he said. But it's very strange, because part of the deal, and I haven't communicated this with Jacob Zuma, I'm talking from an independent perspective, as I understood from previous revelations, that Jacob Zuma's court case or his illegal costs would have been paid by the state as long as he is challenging all the accusations against him. That was part of the deal given to him when he resigned as president on full benefits. That was an agreement between the government of South Africa and Jacob Zuma. So Jacob Zuma essentially does not have legal costs. Besides, the one instance where he had to pay the security for costs for the Mohan case, they had to be, when he started with the private prosecution, he had to put in money there. I believe that would have been for his pocket. And I believe that apparently I've actually seen payments that were made by Louis Liebenberg on behalf of his businesses to Jacob Zuma and also the legal team at that point in time. So when Louis Liebenberg also revealed that he apparently paid 28 million rand, I just thought, but wait a bit. If Jacob Zuma's court cases are supposed to be paid in full by the government of South Africa, and Dalim Pofu and everyone are being paid by the state attorney's office, basically. Now, for what is this 30 million, 28 million rand actually? So I don't know. Sorry, people, I don't know whether that has truly gone to legal costs. I surely haven't seen one cent of that, because I'm doing free of charge work. So whether they might be, there was an occasion where someone also had a deal with Jacob Zuma to take his case to the United Nations, and then they would do it also free of charge, but their cost that they have agreed to must be paid by, or they're going to go to donors and collect money for his legal cases, so that their costs can be funded by donors. And I've told Jacob Zuma then, but oh shucks, this is not on. Cannot do. And there's going to be a clash between the African Union process and if ever such a process would be initiated. And as far as I know, that process has never been initiated. But I've told him that what is actually going to happen is those guys will go and collect money for them for the legal costs for Jacob Zuma, and then at the end of the day are going to pocket it for them. I'm not going to say, you can figure out what I'm trying to say, but I can't think for one minute that Jacob Zuma would suddenly out of the blue intentionally stop all communication with me. I truly believe that Jacob Zuma is being prevented from communicating with me. As long as I have got his actual physical instruction in writing that I may act on his behalf before, in any matter relating to the African Union case, I will continue doing it until such time that he himself tells me that, sorry, your services is no longer required. I haven't received that appeal yet and will not stop representing him and fighting for his and the rights of the uMkhonto Wesizwe party under these circumstances. And let me show you what I did. When I heard, the fact that I have not been asked to come to the hearing on Friday, I then accepted that the 7 May judgment, unanimous judgment, was not only for amicus curiae, but it was for both interested party and for an amicus. So they did not say specifically dealt with the Rule 8. And that is a problem that I have with the Constitutional Court. The Constitution specifically says that any matter before the Constitutional Court must be heard by at least 8 judges. There are 11 full-time judges in total. It's the 8 judges plus the deputy chief justice and also the chief justice, and then there are usually 2 additional acting judges. So there's a total of 13 that can actually sit as 8. So you can imagine that it's an extremely tedious task for the Constitutional Court to consider each and every case. But it's not the Supreme Court of Appeal and the High Court can and may, in terms of the Constitution, decide or consider cases. So that implies that they can either have a hearing or they can do it on paper. But that luxury is not available to the Constitutional Court because of the fact that they must physically hear a case. So it means that it must be before them and they must hear it, not consider it on papers. But unfortunately, that is what the Constitutional Court had been doing for many years now, that they have been considering cases arbitrarily on the papers without any hearing, and we must just accept it. And this is, as I have been always saying, that I don't believe that if there are, let's say, 1,000 cases lodged to the Constitutional Court, and there's only 13 judges, and each and every time 8 of them must consider pages and pages and sometimes bundles and trolleys full of papers, I don't think that they would be able to get through all of those cases. So I have had the assumption and the belief, and I believe that I've got enough circumstantial evidence to prove that some of these cases are just summarily judged by a panel or maybe just by the registrar and said that they have considered it, and then because maybe they have been given the instructions when they see that it's a self-represented time-wasting individual, then just kick it to there's no need to push it through to the judges for consideration. So what happened in my case is that it was a slip. It was a very terrible slip, because if 8 judges unanimously adjudicated my application, they would have judged Rule 8 as well, not only Rule 10. They would not have kicked it to the sideline only for Rule 10 if they have not made any decision whatsoever in terms of the Rule 8 that I have actually was my first option. So then I said, okay, but this is, I thought that no, they would not have been so stupid not to deal with Rule 8. So they would maybe expect me to come and argue that. The fact that they have not done so implies that it was intended for both. And I again confirm it, because on Monday, I've submitted another application to court to rescind, to actually declare the... So I've submitted this application to court on Monday as an urgent application that the non-compliance with the rules must be condoned in terms of Rule 12, and direct access be granted in terms of Section 167(6)(a) insofar it be required, and then that the alleged order of this court dated the 7th of May by all those judges in the matter of Reyno De Beer as applicant to be admitted as either an interested party on amicus curiae be declared as null and void up initio. Alternative to item 3, that the order of this court dated 7 May by Blitz and all those judges as applicant to be admitted be set aside. So, and that I must either be admitted then as an intervening party in terms of Rule 8 or Rule 10. So, in terms of this, I've lodged an urgent application to say, well, you've made a mistake. I'm well aware of the fact that you're currently pondering, deciding on this matter, which you have heard now on Friday. But this is a miscarriage of justice. You have to hear and allow me to intervene and be heard. Because you have judged on the 7th of May, you've incorrectly judged this, if you have ever. Because I doubt whether they have, because otherwise they would have been clearly biased, or alternatively they would have been incompetent. Both of them, I honestly believe, did not happen. And then the other one is it was fraudulently obtained. So it means that it was judged not by them, but by someone else. And in that event, I wanted them to then refer the matter for criminal investigation to the National Director of Public Prosecutions. So people, I've submitted this application and I've revealed everything. And this application is also on our Telegram group. This is a short one. It basically said that there was a mistake. I couldn't have done this. I've explained that I was in Bloemfontein and they knew it. I've explained to them that it seems as if I was expected to come and move my intervention application, but I was never notified of it. So I've explained all those important matters in year. Very importantly, in year I have indicated that of the strange media blackout, because I've informed the media about this, and it appears that everyone is now blocking this. The media doesn't want to publish anything about it. The Constitutional Court knows about it. I've identified that Chief Justice Zondo was made aware on the 26th of May already about this. My interest in the main application are significant and evident. Despite my disclosures, this court seemingly chose not to consider them, as the Chief Justice is aware. I had hoped for transparency from the court and anticipated the discussion of these matters during Friday's hearing, which unfortunately did not happen. However, I previously submitted the actual decision under a highly confidential letter to this court via the registrar on 28th of April. This is indicated clearly by the cover page bearing the court stamp as shown in annexure RS 11. So RS 11, there is the papers that I've shown you. Now, strangely enough, what do you think happened to this application? I've received confirmation that it was sent through to the judges by the registrar. And strangely, as I was busy sending out media releases about this application as well, I suddenly, just shortly thereafter, received a court order again dismissing my application. But listen to this. Let me go to that court order I received yesterday. This is this header is wrong, because I should be actually referred to as an intervening party. So I wasn't against Jacob Zuma. This is also just normal process. In order, because he was a party, I had to cite him also as a respondent in my intervention application. But they have not opposed it at all, as can expect it. But listen to this. Again, the same judges considered it. The Constitutional Court has considered the application lodged on 13 May. It has concluded that it must be dismissed because it is not in the interest of justice to entertain it, as from 7 May until after the hearing on 10 May, the applicant did nothing about the nature of the order issued on 7 May. The court has decided not to hold court. I'm totally speechless, because if they made a clear mistake to just kick my application to the sideline, the one of the 6th of May, and they made a wrong order, not addressing the Rule 8 aspects of the application, only the Rule 10, They now blame me to say that I've made the mistake. So the registrar never informed me that there would have been a hearing. I could have then been there or at least notified the registrar beforehand to say that, you know, that in my papers, first papers, I've indicated that I couldn't be there. People, this is what we are at. And I'm going to make another video to disclose the actual content of the intervention application and the conflict of interest that existed between CASAC and counsel for the state and the president, Jeff Buntlender, all who have always been members of CASAC, the Council for the Advancement of the South African Constitution, but they have been the mouthpiece of Cyril Ramaphosa himself. And I'm going to show you in the next episode that I'm going to make how Cyril Ramaphosa and CASAC have directly influenced the judges that were sitting on both my case in the Supreme Court of Appeal and also the judges in the cases which have pondered the imprisonment sentence of Jacob Zuma. That is going to be a revelation that you do not want to be missed. So I'm just going to stop this so that you you can just process everything that I've said. And I guarantee you that the next episode of this will be an automatic revelation that there has been corruption going on in the cases, not only of Jacob Zuma, but also in my Supreme Court of Appeal case. Undoubtedly. And that brings me to the point that all these revelations have been made to the media. And they just want to keep it away from you because there's going to be consequences. They know that. Because if the people knows about this, and more other political parties and so forth are going to reveal the content of this, it's going to be the end of the ANC and Cyril Ramaphosa specifically. And they don't want that because through Cyril Ramaphosa, all these media houses have been funded. We want to know actually whether from who they have actually received monies, because that is what the media houses have actually now confirmed. Why would they conceal this valuable information, important public interest information, and not receive any benefit of it? Or who has intimidated them? We want to know. Has anyone came to say that, intimidated you? We want to know. But people, you can find these documents on our Telegram group. Just join it, Liberty Fighters Network News. You go and read it. It's just going to flabbergast you, really. Until the next episode, God bless, Godspeed.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.